Piotr, can we record your presentation?
Absolutely, please. Yes.
Okay. And may I ask Thomas whether it's possible for him to remove the camera so that we may have less problem in the connection? Thank you, Thomas. Please.
Okay. Can you see my presentation? Because I'm working with two screens. It's fine, everything? Rocco, can you see my presentation
yes,
now?
Yes.
It's fine. Yes,
okay,
yes.
Thank you very much.
Sorry,
fine.
I was muted. Okay. Sorry, I was
okay.
muted.
So as I said, subject is optical coherence tomography. And this is something which is quite popular technique in medicine, actually. You can find this instrument, which you can see here, two quite popular models in ophthalmological, say, at hospital or just at the practitioner, because it's used for examination of eye, mostly for very, unfortunately, very popular disease, which is called age-related macular degeneration, which is kind of social sickness. About, it is estimated that about 50% of population over 60 suffers from this more or less, and this is kind convenient technique for diagnosis. Okay, so why we do this? Because we believe that this is sort of alternative for sampling. This way of sampling I'm showing here is a little bit exaggerated, but essentially sampling is taking a piece of element from the object. With OCT, we can produce similar images, I mean cross sections, but without, of course, any harm to the object. It's totally non-invasive. Also, it's fast, doesn't need any preparation of the object, and also, since it doesn't need any other interventions, can be repeated as much as many times as you need, and doesn't take too much time. So this is why we have decided some years ago actually to start this, not too much after the OCT was introduced into medical practice as well. What it is, essentially this is what you see here, is a sort of optical radar. You know this kind of interaction with police, which we don't really like, but happens from time to time. And essentially this is something everybody's familiar with radar, and this is LiDAR. This is a light emitter which sends lights to the object, and the reflected light is analyzed. In this case, this analysis is used to determine the speed of the object, but we use it to determine the internal structure. So what we usually see, we see the object which is composed of some semi-transparent layers, but what we want to do, we want to actually see how these layers are structured, what is the order and thickness of layers of the object of interest. Could be, for instance, the painting with some varnishes, with some glazes, and so on. Okay, I'm not going into details how it works, just two slides. Generally, it is an interferometer, optical interferometer. We use a light of low intensity. Usually, it is infrared light. So if we have such an interferometer, if we just send some light from the source, it splits into two arms. And if the lengths are matched, this light doesn't interfere and we have no signal. But if we move this mirror to such a distance that we have the same distances, then this light meets, and due to the interaction, we have a signal at the detector. This is the essential of optical coherence tomography. It comes from the very famous and fundamental works by Albert Abraham Michelson from the beginning of 20th century, and finally was turned into the medical diagnostic tool by Professor James Fujimoto from MIT. And then we come about 2010 and start to do it for objects. Okay, here you have three kinds of OCT devices which are available on the market. This first one with this movable mirror, it is historically the first one, but very inconvenient because since you have to move something, it's very slow, so it's not practical. Then you can use, instead of this moving mirror, you use the here the spectrograph, a Fourier transformation, to get exactly the same result. Or what is also possible is to use a special source, which is called sweep source, which actually very fastly changes the wavelength, and also the light is analyzed by Fourier transformation and gets the quite similar results. Here you have some pro and contra of these techniques. I'm not going now into details. Practically speaking, what is now practically used is this mostly spectral domain OCT, which is this one, and also sweep source systems, which they have some interesting advantages, mostly because of very long wavelengths, which can be utilized here. This is how the instrument may look like. This is our machine. With in front of the object, we have a kind of tripod with the head plus some electronics. And what is most important here is low intensity of light, infrared, and actual resolution about 2 microns in depth resolution, okay? And we can imagine the thickness up to 1.5 millimeter. And also it was to mention that the lateral resolution is about, depends on the optics, is a few microns. What is important is also this, because this distinguish OCT from typical micrometric techniques, because the field of view is rather broad. In this standard system, in our machine, is like up to 17 by 17 millimeters. Of course, if we need a better resolution, we have to compromise and we go to the lower field of view, but still pretty big if we comparing this with the typical microscope, okay? This can be also used working horizontally, so we can put a painting on the table and look from the top, of course. This is, by the way, Dr. Iwanicka, who is also a co-author of this lecture. As I said, she is not able to join us. And this is another way. This is our this is a photo from our MOLAB action in London, in Whitehall banqueting hall, where the paintings by Rubens been analyzed here, placed on the ceiling, and the beam was facing upwards, and we also can analyze this paintings. Okay, what we get? This is the example of the result. Okay, so we have here a structure of this painting. It belongs to the Ghent altar, by the way, and here you see this upper line. It is the boundary between air and the painting. Then we have a few layers of varnish. And finally, this last layer is the opaque paint layer. And this is the final boundary of the application of this technique, because since it is an optical technique, it could be used only for transparent and semi-transparent objects. This is a major limitation. And this is like a linear cross-section. So this is why I call it tomography, because what we see here is actually a cross-section. What we can do also, we can do many cross-sections like here, and then we have a set of images. Usually we collect like 150 images like this in the distance of, let's say, 10 micrometers or something like that from each other. And we have a few, we have a nice insight into the structure of the object, considered in this way as a cube of data. Some instruments are available on the market. This is the situation coming from the Thorlabs catalog of 2020. They have different features. This red circle shows the most interesting, like this system has a short best resolution, but this system has a little bit lower but higher sensitivity, and so on, so on, and for different wavelengths. Also, these two instruments, both of them are laboratory built, is our instrument, and this is instrument from Nottingham Trent University. Both of them are available via MOLAB mechanism of Hyperion project. I will come to this at the end for a second. Okay, what to take home after this? First, OCT is an optical and non-invasive tomographic technique because the intensity is very low. Actual resolution is in the range of few micrometers, as you could see here before, was like from 2 to up to, let's say, 10 micrometers. Important, the longer the wavelength, the lower the actual resolution. This is physics. We cannot actually avoid this. Like these two final systems, this system has a 3 microns at about 900 nanometers. This is two micrometers system. Very long wavelength, better penetration, but the resolution is only 17. Okay, and lateral in-plane resolution is about few micrometers. And what is important is completely decoupled from the actual resolution. So this is different than in microscopy, where it is usually some kind of relationship between both. And as I said, it must be applied only to at least semi-transparent structures, because whatever is opaque for the given wavelength, of course, this is the end of the range which can be used. And for the last of my talk, let me just talk about applications, because I think this is more interesting, mostly case studies. But before, let me just explain you a little bit more about how to read this tomogram. This is against the tomogram, and these colors here, they coded not a real color of the object, but the scatter intensity. So the more warm color, the higher scattering. Okay? And so usually varnish boundary or interface is high scattering, so it takes like a yellow color, like here. Then we have moderately scattered paint, and much less scattered glazes. Air is completely black, okay, because it's not scattering light at all. And like this tiny line, what it is, this is just a boundary between two layers of varnish. The upper one is a little bit pigmented because we see a little bit more of signal here also from the bulk of this layer, and below is the second layer completely transparent. So how it works, lights come here, reflects, and comes back. But this arrow shows this kind of tails here. Why we have these tails? What they tell us? This is a little bit different story. As I said, here we have a single scattering, so light comes and goes back. If we have a scattering within the layer, the situation is a little bit more complicated. So light before it is actually of course, not all. Some photons will come back to our detector. They are many times scattered inside the layer. Of course, our machine doesn't know about it and thinks that this signal comes not just from here, multi-scattered, but deeper from the volume of this layer. So this is what our machines see. Of course, this is exaggerated, but essentially this tells us only nothing about the internal structure of this layer, but tells us that this layer is significantly scattering light, which we are using. Sometimes it can be used even to distinguish between different pigments. Here we have two examples. Cobalt blue is highly scattering at our wavelengths, so we see the same tails like here. Prussian blue absorbs completely near infrared light, so we have signal only from the surface. Whatever goes inside is absorbed and never come back. So it is visible here as a black area. But generally, OCT is not sensitive. It cannot be used to directly identify pigment. This is rather for the structure of the painting. This is kind of exemption, not a real, very often situation. Okay, so this is another examples here. As I mentioned before, we have these two layers of different scattering properties, and at the end is the old priming. So this is now the real examples. here's a little bit interesting thing, because here we have a paint, this red one, on top of the gold or metal foil. And I just want to point your attention to this here. This is an artifact, and it comes from very simple reason. So what happens? Light comes here, and you see it double reflects. But of course, again, our machine doesn't know. It interprets this light, which comes out after this double reflection, as coming from such a higher depth. So this is why we have this not existing signal here. So sometimes when we analyze our OCT images, we must be aware of various artifacts which must be taken into account. Not often, but sometimes also they are interesting because they permit to draw some more conclusions. Okay, here is a list of applications, more or less up to date. So you can see it could be used for two general purposes, for structure examination and for monitoring of real-time monitoring, because it's fast, of different procedures. With this blue now, I just marked these things we are using in our practice. And I will, of course, we have no time to show all this, but I will show you a few examples most related to varnish and glaze layers. But as you can see, here is many other applications which could be also mentioned, but unfortunately we will not have time for this. So sequence and thickness of varnish and glaze layers on easel paintings. Okay, first example, this is a beautiful painting, La Muta, from Museum in Urbino by Raphael. And if one look at the UV-induced fluorescence, we see these dark spots here, okay? Usually, you know that these dark spots are interpreted as some kind of retouching and actions like this. However, in this case, it's not homogeneous, and we just did, and the same situation is here. It's also obviously darker luminescence than from the other areas, okay? So to properly interpret this effect, we did OCT, and exactly in this place. And what we see here, we just see that in this area, where we have a lower fluorescence, we have much thinner varnish. And the same here. If we compare this area, which is here of this fabric here, and this, which is directly of this torso here, we have the same situation. So in this case, we can say for sure that this effect seen at routine UV fluorescence examination are not caused by overpainting. They're just caused by the thinner layer of varnish, probably after some attempts of restoration, maybe some testing of solvents, we don't know, because it's not documented at all. But obviously, it's no visible any trace of intervention, because this is also an example of how OCT can be useful. Because if we would have here some interventions like, I don't know, overpainting, adding some putty or whatever, it will be very clearly visible in our OCT data and identified. This is another example. This concern sunflowers and Van Gogh Museum. These people are queuing here, but it says that Sonnenblumen are not available, okay? Because it was not on exhibition, it was at the atelier where we did some examinations of this together with our colleagues from Perugia, from MoLA, okay? And here is one example. This was quite interesting thing because actually this was published after in a book by museum, but this concerned the traces of previous undocumented restoration, which happened before the Second World War, I believe. And this this area here, because we obviously see two varnishes, now you know how to read it. This is the paint layer, and we have this mysterious layer in between. And after OCT, also after other examinations, we came to the conclusion that these are traces of some glazing applied by the restorer to optically match different areas after his attempt to remove varnish. And this was because he actually revarnished it. And so the problem, general problem with this painting is about the quality of this varnish and about the possibility of its removal. I will come to this in a moment. Here, another problem. This is so-called lead soap formation at the painting, again, here in this area. As you can see, again, two varnishes and so on, similar. But this lead soap, it is, as you know, effect of reaction between the oil in the binder and lead. And this, the product, the soap, it has a bigger volume than his substrates and may lead to the destruction of the paint layer. Here you see this like a little crater. However, what we can see here that this is covered by varnish, which tells us that this process stopped already and doesn't impose any further threat to the painting. So this protrusion is actually only belongs to the history of this painting. It is no ongoing process. We couldn't find any evidence on ongoing protrusion of soil formation. Oh, here it is how this looks at the under microscope. Okay, so this is this hole here, but everything is nicely covered by varnish and stable. Okay, this is another situation with different different soap here, also covered by varnish. Here, this is a documentation of some flakes of paint against overpainted by varnish and completely soaked in this varnish. And again, it tells us the situation in this area is completely stable because we don't see any damage to the varnish itself. So whatever is under is protected and stabilized at the place. So it's no need to intervene. Okay, before I go further, this generally the conclusion of this all this experiment also with using OCT for tracing varnish removal, that it is not possible to safely remove the varnish, and finally the decision was made not to do it, just do some very local surface cleaning without the removing of this non-original, of course, varnish, because this painting generally was not varnished by the Van Hoogh, and but whatever, all this is so hard and so mixed up that any attempt to remove this varnish may be very, very harmful to the painting. Another object is this beautiful painting from the Leonardo da Vinci studio. This is internal of Ufficio della Pietradura in Florence, when we just did it, some examination of it before it was sent for restoration. And we got like a couple hours access to this painting. We managed to collect all these points. And here you have some examples of results. So as like here, everything is fine. We have a paint layer, we have varnish, and we have, of course, this is the surface, this is air. But in other places, there are these areas of overpainting. But what can be immediately seen here is that this overpainting is nicely separated from the original paint layer, and also that many of the paint layers actually below still present. And to investigate it further, this kind of approach can be used. We developed especially for this problem. So having collected our cube of data, then we can virtually analyze a surface, a slice, better say, which is parallel to the surface of the painting. Here is the surface of the painting. Here's our slide. And then we can, by changing the depth, we can see what happens at the given depth under the surface. Of course, above the surface is nothing. Because this is the structure of our painting. We have something on the surface, then, oh, and now it moves, you see? And so we go deeper and deeper, and so we can see what happened on the surface, what happens below, and until we reach the paint layer. Here is the result. Surface, below the surface, between the varnish and the paint layer below the this other paint. Okay? At given depth of the from counted from the surface. So again, here is the result. This is what happened very close to the surface. Here is below, about 30 microns below. Here is on the depth of 50 microns. And so this is the paint layer. We have a shadow of this overpaint, of course, but for sure here is much more paint. This is vastly overpainted. And the reason for all this was a transfer, because this painting was transferred from wood to canvas. And this process, of course, done in 19th century was very harmful to the object, and then restorer or renovator in this time had to fix it somehow, so he made all these other paintings. Here is another example from this painting. So this is what we see at the surface. This is this overpainting in this different place, but essentially the same thing. Simply all this is overpainted, okay? This piece of arm, I believe it is. Then we see this structure, which looks like a canvas, but this is not a canvas because we are above. This is just a surface of the painting, but as you can see here, this surface actually supposed to repeat the structure of the canvas, okay? And finally, if we go a little bit deeper, we see a regular paint layer. As you can see, it's not such a bad situation. It's plenty of paint here. So it is fairly possible to remove this overpaint. Okay? We can analyze this and by Fourier transformation get also information about the structure of this canvas. This remaining of canvas in the paint layer. And what is completely surprising, that the real canvas, which is below, which can be of course analyzed with regular X-ray examination, has completely different this pitch here. So it tells us that for this painting, this transfer was made twice. One first from the wood to not existing now canvas, which only we can see by how it is incised in the paint. And then again, this one was removed because we don't see it in Röntgen at all. Removed, and we have a new canvas of a different structure, which can be seen in regular X-ray. This is another example. This is a Bessarion reliquary, which is now in Venice. And this is quite interesting story about it. Generally, it goes down to 15th century when 15th century, yes, okay. When Bessarion, who was a Catholic bishop of Constantinople, was sent to Italy to beg help against Turks, being, of course, sieged Constantinople, and he was, I mean, equipped with some pieces of art, of some, and one of them was this beautiful reliquary, this is a Stavrotek, reliquary of the Holy Cross. This is the place for, of course, all the Holy Cross pieces. No, I think here, sorry. This. And also, and of course, what is interesting, that before he actually bring it to Venice, this was already like a couple hundred years old, and he ordered the renovation down in 15th century. And then it came to the Opificio Pietradura when we had an opportunity again to analyze it. And what we have here, okay, this is how it looks. Now this is this places for reliquaries. And we've been interested in this bordure of paintings. And there are some places of examination. First thing here, again, this technique of making, getting slides from different slices, sorry, from different depths. This is almost from the surface. This is just an existing craquelure, which can be seen here. This is deeper. These are these pieces here. And they give this effect of this shining, this yellow blinks. And deeper, at very deep, about 270 micrometers, it is actually a paint layer. So what it is? These are cracks in between two layers of varnish caused by exposition to sun. Because we've been told that only one half of this object has this problem, because when he was exposed in Venice, he was for a couple hundred years staying at the same place, and only one half of this painting was actually directly exposed to sun. And this is where why we see it only at one half of this painting, only at this side, I believe. Okay, so this different layers with different effects. Another thing comes to this gold here, because we have this golden lines, and this is the OCT cross section. So if we take now data from this layer, we see like only the upper parts of this gold. If we go deeper, then this is real reflection from gold. Okay, we see shadows here because gold is not transparent, so we don't see anything below. And even we can, from here, we can even say something about a tool which was used. Okay, if we go deeper, and even more deeper, we see now shadows of this gold drawing, but also tracing of the original gold. Because what's happened here, this, what we see here, belongs to this restoration in 15th century, where the renovator, restorer, just put a new layer of varnish, make these grooves, and put gold inside, with some, just leaving some remainings of the old gilding below. So this is the original, and this is the, of course, original, but from 15th century restoration. So we can actually trace here sort of workshop of the restorer, your grandfathers from 15th century when they did the restoration of this object. Okay. And another thing, this is the painting by Jacob van Walskapel. It came from one of Polish museums. And what we did here, we did a macro XRF scanning. I believe tomorrow will be a special lecture about this. I'm just showing these pictures here because they give you an insight about technique. Calcium means, of course, these are some restorations, some putties, iron, darks, manganese with the signature here, okay, and copper, but zinc doesn't fit to 17th century, of course, yes? So why we have this thing white here? And similar with barium. I don't know, you have a barium here? No, I don't. Okay, so this is again the same image with this traces of zinc. So we did OCT to actually answer this question. What happened? Why we have this thing interventions here, because if they are original, it means that this cannot be a painting from 17th century, of course. So let's take a closer look at one of these tulips here. Here we have a combination of barium and zinc. Okay, and let's take a look at this area. What we have, this is how it looks like on photography. This is our OCT. And what is, let me see what I have here. Okay, and so this is this place. So what we see here, this is the surface, two layers of varnish, and then at the depth of 25 microns, we have this beautifully visible as a barium line. So obviously it does not belong to the original painting. This is the original painting at the depth of 38 microns. And so it is a trace of some restoration where the certain elements of this painting been repainted with barium and zinc white, or maybe a mixture to put to make it look better. But by OCT, we were able to actually separate the original paint layer from these add-ons, so we can say for sure that these traces cannot be used for the dating of the painting. Okay? Even deeper. So these are probably the original this element here. And so similar examination can be done for different objects, as you can see, ceramic, glass, and so on, so on. I just want to show you finally something about the monitoring, because as I said, OCT is very fast, so we can actually monitor some processes, both chemical and also laser ablation of varnish. Here we have a chemical. So let's have a object. It is a piece, a fragment of the painting here. And so we scan it with OCT and we're getting our images as before. Now the machine was taken away. The object was cleaned, as you can see, and we do again OCT scanning and we have another slightly different image with a thinner layer of varnish. What we can do, and so on, so on. We can do more cleaning again, slowly going down with the thickness of varnish. And finally, so we can trace it now pretty precisely. When we look at OCT, and also we can see how much of material has been removed. So this is the before cleaning. So of course, nothing is removed. We have zero here. This is how the surface looks like. It's pretty flat. Okay, now if we go step by step, after first step, second, you see we have here more and more removed material. And of course, losing varnish here. And this is the final result. We can measure the thickness. So this is exactly this area here, because looks for a little bit quite homogeneous. So what we can see here, this is quite important for the restorer, because we got here what? Some graduate decrease of the thickness of varnish. Then he got swallowed and softened. So he had very fast decrease of about 15, more probably even 20 microns here. And then again, slower process, probably because the next old layer of varnish was reached. So this means that here we have a proof that the process of removal of varnish is extremely not homogeneous. It may, the speed or the effectiveness of this process can change very rapidly because of the changing of the properties of varnish, and also because of the chemical process of swallowing of this softening of this varnish, which is also very clearly visible here. Okay. So, just to finish, here as I said, we offer OCT in MOLAB, so as two instruments, optical coherence tomography and hydrate 50 and OCT and almost 2 microns. Here you have a data, this is resolution, and so if you want good resolution, you should go for shorter wavelengths. If you need a better penetration, because we know that infrared penetrates better through paint, if the wavelength is longer, you can use this machine. However, the resolution is much, much lower, which for certain applications may be not enough, actually, in my opinion at least. So this is, as you know, you can you know that you can actually apply for MOLAB through the Hyperion HS website. Also, there is a website of this address here where we try to keep all papers related to the use of OCT for examination of artwork or different kind. This is for about violins. This is about painting. This is about cleaning generally. This is about tomb murals and so on, so on. So all sorts of different objects and different applications. As you know, most of them are now open access, easy to access. You have links here, so you are very welcome to also look there. And this is what I would like to tell you. And this is supposed to prove that OCT was also well known in antiquity, because this mosaic comes somewhere in Italy. I don't remember exactly from what. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions?
You're welcome. Thank you really very much. If you can just remove the...
Okay. Is it okay? Yeah?
It is okay. Now we can see you.
Fine.
Thank you really.